game-winning goal came from Hendricks with a great feed to Dennis Sear, but Coach Pat Kelly's nerves don't like these come-from-behind wins.
What that club played with tonight in the third period, that's what our club should play all the time. For some reason or not. What, I'll find out this week. We've got 4 days to practice, and we're going to have to sit down, have some meetings, and talk about it.
Right now, the Peoria Rivermen are hot. Tonight at the Civic Center, they came from 3 goals down to beat Salt Lake City, 5-3, chalking up their third straight victory. Third period, Doug Evans slices Salt Lake City's lead to 3-2 on a power play when he deflects a shot by Rick Hendricks. Then 2 minutes later, Peoria is back on the power play when number 11, Brian Shaw, scores. First of 2 goals by Shaw tonight. This one coming on the rebound to tie the game at 3-all. And then at 9:31 of the third period, number 8, Dennis Sear, deflects Hendricks' shot to make it 4-3. The Rivermen win 5-3, but Coach Pat Kelly thought they played poorly for the first 40 minutes.
We should have played like we did in the third period, the first period. Get them down. We know they're coming off. This is their third game in 3 nights. It's only our second game in 2 nights. For some reason lately, we haven't been doing that. What that club played with tonight in the third period, that's what our club should play all the time.
Peoria plays again Friday at Indianapolis. Most from his team, he'd probably tell you, balance scoring and consistency. Most hockey coaches will say that. Well, right now, Kelly must be pleased with the club's performance in both of those categories. The Rivermen got goals from 8 different players tonight and ran their unbeaten string to 6 games with an 8-6 triumph at the Civic Center over the Kalamazoo Wings. Third period action, Kalamazoo with the puck. Number 10, Rob Davies, drops it back to Bill Schaffhauser at the point. He blasts it by Rick Hines. It's tied at 6-6. Then at 14:23 of the period, Lee Norwood rips a big slap shot. The goaltender, Ron Hextall, stops it, but number 8, Dennis Sear, and number 12, John Goodwin, are there for the rebound. Goodwin got credit for the goal, making it 7-6 Peoria. And finally, Mike Prestige skates past to the defenseman, scores the goal, 8-6.
In Kalamazoo last night, 3-2, to share the top spot with Salt Lake City in the International Hockey League's Western Division. Peoria hit the ice tonight, putting its top spot and a 5-game winning streak on the line. If you like hockey tonight, then you'll love this game. It was a word, excitement. Excitement was the word. Don Killer opened up the scoring as Peoria slaps this one home for a 1-0 lead in the midpoint of the first period. Then just as the fans calmed down, the Rivermen did it again as Doug Evans gives the assist to Dave McQueen as the Rivermen were on the move. They went on to win it in a big one, stretching their unbeaten streak to 6 while staying on top of the IHL's Western Division by downing Kalamazoo 8.
A goal when it appeared that it hit the crossbar. Let's see it again. It's a high shot, but you never actually see it go in the top of the net. For Mullen, it was his 16th goal of the year. Then, with about 8 minutes to play, Buffalo's Dave Andrechuk takes a rebound off the goalpost and flips it behind St. Louis goalie Mike Liut for a 3-2 Buffalo lead. There it stayed, the saber of violence in the NHL during the pre-Wayne Gretzky era. But on the minor league level, things have yet to evolve the way they have in recent years in the National Hockey League. The game still gets very ugly at times. This episode coming up is one of many that occurred in last night's Peoria Rivermen victory over Toledo at Carver Arena. 13 players were ejected, many of them leaving after a third period bench-clearing brawl. All of this is probably the fault of the IHL schedule maker. Last night marked the third consecutive meetings of the teams in a week. Now, could you imagine two football teams playing each other 3 times in a row? Later on this season, Peoria gets to play Indianapolis.
High center, and the Rivermen skates and puts in it 1-0 right there. The Rivermen go on and score 2 more goals in the night to knock off Kalamazoo and capture sole possession of the IHL Western Division with a 3-2 victory.
And they play tomorrow night in Fort Wayne. What a place to spend New Year's Eve. Bob Fleming scored the Rivermen first goal here in the first period. Only 19 seconds after entering the game, it was 1-0. Second period, Kalamazoo took a 2-1 lead with Brent Jarrett's breakaway. Still in the second, Lee Norwood misses from the point, but the hammer, Fleming, again knocks it in, ties it at 2. And then Perry Ganscher got the winner in the third period, but Bob the Hammer Fleming was definitely the star tonight.
Is limited to what he can do on the ice when it's a close game, and fortunately I used him a couple of times. He scored 2 goals, but that's his big thing in front of that net.
It's not usually like me, but I was playing with Denny Sear and John Goodwin, and they're both so easy to play with. They gave me some nice passes, and I had to, you know, just really tap in goals around the net. But
we're going to try and stress more playing defensively and work on that part of our game, and then the goals will come. I think we have a tendency to cheat a little bit too much and try and go for the goals too much, and then we get caught and we get ourselves in a hole.
Scoring the first 2 Peoria goals, but it was number 10, Perry Ganscher, who scored the eventual winner on a rebound at 4:39 of the final period. The Rivermen then killed off a two-man power play advantage by Kalamazoo later in the period, but with 15 seconds left, goalie Rick Hines had to make the save of the game to protect the victory. Watch him here. He loses the stick, but he covers up, and the Rivermen win 3-2. They're back in first place, and they play tomorrow night at Fort Wayne. All right, and the
Jacks lead it. Now, just 1 minute later, the Rivermen cut the deficit in half. Perry Gantcher puts it through in the Lumberjacks' defense, and it's now 2-1. In the second period, the Rivermen trailed 3-1 when matters got worse. Shutt does it again, and Peoria trails by 3 goals. The Rivermen stay within reach with 2 unanswered goals. Dave McQueen's red lighter here makes it 4-3. After Muskegon answers with another score, so does McQueen. 5-4, Lumberjacks lead after 2 periods, and right now, Peoria lost it 5-4.
To the third period, Peoria leading 5-3 when Mike Prestige and Jerry August set up Brian Shaw at the side of the net. There's the tally. The Rivermen go on to beat Fort Wayne 7-3 and take a 4-point lead in the West Division. Their next game is Wednesday night at home versus Toledo.
In the first period, Perry Gantcher, who leads them in goals, skates in alone and fires from the corner, made it 2-1. Fort Wayne closes the gap in the third period. Ron Leafs with a goal, makes it 4-3, Rivermen. But the Rivermen open it up. Brian Shaw takes a Jerry August pass. He slides it in for a goal, made it 6-3. And then John Goodwin seals the win all alone, fakes once, then scores. The Rivermen win 7-3.
Got to discipline ourselves a little better, staying on our wing, picking up our man a little more. Maybe this will help us down the road. I think they played better position hockey tonight. And when you play a club with Fort Wayne, you have to play well, or else you're not going to beat them.
You know, every time it seems like we're just ready maybe to fall down, we come through with something big. It was 4-3. You know, we already lost 2 games this week. And boom, we got that 5th goal, and we just went from there.
We've been having trouble putting the puck in the net. We've been having a lot of chances, but we just haven't been putting them in the net. So tonight was a big win for us. We needed it. Put us 4 points up in first place.
Here, Mike Posavod welcomes Toledo's Blake Steven back to Peoria. Come on, cut it out, guys. Get back to hockey. Bob Fleming caused some commotion tonight, but not with his fist. Fleming gives the Rivermen a 4-3 lead with his 11th goal of the year in the second. Toledo comes back to take a 5-4 lead on this long shot by Darcy Roy in the third. Bunny Larocque caught napping there. But then Dennis Sear knots it at 5-5 with this power play. Coming up, the game was tied 5 times tonight. But
this came up from the Blues, got the winning goal. Here, take a look at first period action breakaway. Vince Sabek, one pass, Bunny Larocque. It's tied at 2. Later, Rivermen get the lead. Don Keller slips one to Bob Fleming, and the hammer knocks it in. Toledo, later in the game, they lost a guy with an injury. He was carried off and had a neck brace put on, but he's okay, and was in the hospital, checked out, but again, he's all right. 6-5, Peoria, they'll be
here. He made several other big saves tonight. Peoria gets on the board first with some help from Jim Burton, who forgets which goal is his. Clears it right to Jerry August, and he scored twice tonight for the Rivermen. Third period now. Watch number 8, Dennis Sear, gets the feet out of the corner, and the game's tied up at 4-all. 7 minutes later, it's Sear to the rescue again. Mike Prestige is going to be on target with a pass. And this was the game winner. Final score, Rivermen 6, Fort Wayne 5. Peoria hosts Indianapolis on Saturday.
Highlights after this, so stick with us. After all, he's maybe going to pick up a couple of points on the Rivermen. Watch the save here coming up by Nick Rickey. The youngster in goal tonight rejects it. And in the second period, Mark Botel tied it. The Rivermen would go ahead to win tonight 6-5.
Rivermen pull off a big one tonight as they beat Fort Wayne 6-5 with a goalie who hadn't played in 11 months. Nick Rickey was replacing Bunny Larocque, who mysteriously and unexpectedly left town this afternoon. Now, the Rivermen got off to a fast start. Jerry August slid one through. It's 1-0 Rivermen, but Fort Wayne came back strong against Nick. That made it 1-1. A nice shot by Steve Salucci. Ron Leaf will come up next. 4:32 left in the first period. And Nick looked a little slow on that one, but heck, he hadn't played in 11 months. The Rivermen came back, and with a 3-2, the Comets, Jerry August makes it 3-3. They go on and score the winning goal with 50 seconds left. They win 6-5. The Rivermen are now 7 points up ahead of Fort Wayne, and Nick Rickey is our...
Instead of a hockey game, tempers weren't the only thing that flared as the Rivermen started to roll. In the first period, John Goodwin passes to Dave McQueen, who shoots off the post, back to Goodwin, and he puts it home as Peoria takes a 1-0 lead. The Rivermen found the net 5 more times and surrendered only 4 goals, and they won it 6-4, and they have a 7-point lead over Fort Wayne.
Most of the people who showed up were one of the smallest crowds of the season right now, watching Peoria leading Flint in a makeup game. Well, who would want to watch a bunch of hockey players look for a contact lens anyway? They had problems with the post, actually. Start delayed 45 minutes. But new Rivermen goalie Daryl May wasn't rusty. A nice stop early kept Flint off the board.
The Peoria was back on 30 seconds later. Dennis Sear watches the puck carom off his skate and in. Sometimes first place teams good luck.
In those playoffs with home ice tonight at the Civic Center, first place in the West met second place in the East as the Rivermen faced the Flint Generals. Beat him by the score of 7-5. Harry Gantcher was on the ice, of course, tonight for the first time in a long while. He had two goals. So did Lee Norwood. It was tied at a goal apiece, and Bob the Hammer finds Lee, and boom, 2-1, and that was all she wrote from there. Oh, Dave Nichols, thank you very much. Kaboom. He gets one by May and then takes the spill. It's even at 2. Riverman Perry Gantcher, his first goal of the evening. Nice pass from Brad Kepthorne, 3-2. Again, it's Kepthorne, bang, right there, and Gantcher again, 4-2. In favor of the Rivermen. Here's a shot from the point.
Gates in and scores unassisted, and the Rivermen take a 3-1 lead at that point. Don Murdoch cuts the lead to 1 for Muskegon, firing a shot through the glove of goalie Darryl May. It's 3-2, and the Rivermen score on a power play goal in the third. Perry Gantcher finds the loose puck, lifts it in at 6-3. Rivermen, Murdoch cut the lead to 1 again, knocking the puck past May, but Don Keller gets the empty netter. Rivermen wins 7-5.
I feel that this club, we need the points now because we're running out of the home games. We've got a lot of home games that we're running off right now. At the end of the month, we're just reversed. We go on the road for 8 games. So we have to win these games while we're at home and then go on the road and win some hockey games.
We had to have a big first period because they always come out at you the first period. We scored a couple goals, got up, helped the morale of the team and let them know that we were going to play tonight and came to play and take 2 points.
We knew, though, that we had, if we want first overall, Muskegon's a team we got to beat, so we knew that if we want to, if we're going to go out and beat them, we have to.
In the league and have blistered their last 5 opponents, and that's a franchise record. Today they captured that record as they totally destroyed the Muskegon Lumberjacks.
The Avalanche started with the game tied at 1-1. Jerry August hits a deflection off his own skate to put the Rivermen up 2-1. August does the job again. This time he goes all the way by himself and hits a between-the-leg shot for a 3-1 Peoria advantage. Muskegon closed the gap at 3-2 when Don Murdoch found the net. Peoria scored one more time in the first as Don Keller got a nice setup for a 4-2 lead after one period. Now in the second period, Peoria does it again. This time, Perry Gantcher gets the rebound and the backhand for a 5-3 Peoria lead. Muskegon came back to within a point at 6-5, but the Rivermen sailed home as Don Keller found an empty net for it.
Might be nice tonight. The Rivermen donned some dark uniforms, the road duds, and there's what happened. Kalamazoo apparently just masqueraded as a hockey team. Here's what the local guys look like on the road. Here's what Kalamazoo goalies looked at all night. Goals, Dave McQueen putting that one on the board for a 2-0 lead. Seconds later, Tony Catelli with another long flip from the blue line. Didn't go in, but Doug Evans' tip did, and the Rivermen were on their way. The Kalamazoo goalie doesn't fare much better on the other side, and I'm back the other end. Rivermen
really get him fired up.
Well, that's the character on this hockey club. I just go in and we go over the things we have to do, and we talk about the things that were going on in the game at the time, and they go out and execute it on the ice for me.
Rick Hines, the veteran, did a nice job last night. Will he be in goal again tonight?
Yes, I think so. I haven't talked to Rick yet today. He said he felt a little tired after last night, but I think that he'll go again tonight.
Talking about tired, you guys have to be fatigued with the trip from Muskegon. How's the physical shape of the team, as well as mental?
Well, outside of Donnie Keller and Jerry August being out, we've got a few aches and pains, but that's nothing unusual for hockey players. The spirit's high. They know there's a lot of guys here that have never won a championship, and we're this close to it, so they don't want to let it go by.
Let's go back to early in last night's game. You guys are down 2-1 and then 2-0 in last night's game. Did you ever lose any confidence?
No, I didn't. I felt, we've come from behind other games being down 2-0. We've been behind in the series 2-1 before in different series. This club, you can't give up on them because they don't give up on themselves, and anything can happen right up into the last minute of play.
Now it's really a best of 3 series. What do the Rivermen have to do better in these next couple games to win?
Well, we have to do just like we did last night, come out and play a complete 60 minutes of hockey. I thought that was our best 60 minutes that we put together in quite a while in the playoffs. We have to do that same thing, and we have to win our 2 home games. That's all we need is we've got the ball in our park now. We've got 2 out of the 3 home games, and we have to come and win our 2 home games at home.
That really does make a big difference, the home crowd, doesn't it?
It certainly does.
Okay, Pat, thanks for your time. Good luck to
play this hat trick by scoring the winning goal with just 49 seconds in the sudden death. Tonight's game, well, should be a heart stopper as well, with the series tied at 2 games apiece. Both teams want this one very badly. Face-off time at Carve Arena is set for 7:35.
Found without a stick. The Rivermen stay on the stick, hit Brian Shaw in front for the open goal. As you'll see, there were some Rivermen fans. After that, bad Indy pass. The Rivermen set up Dennis Sear for a slap shot. Watch. Rob Holland just wasn't ready. Wasn't really a zinger. Something you can't say for Sear. He's ready all night. Finished with an open net goal to tie the series at 2-2. Sear had to lose a few pints to do it.
Everybody was ready. Everybody worked hard, so finally got one here. So now it's two out of three, and we got the home ice advantage back, so that's good.
I said, this is like our home rink, guys. We're four wins, a loss, and a tie here out of six games. So this is just like playing at home. We haven't played this club as good at home as we have here.
The Rivermen host
in five or six nights.
What can the folks look for Wednesday? A conservative game, more physical? Can it be more physical?
Well, it could be more physical, but we're going to go out. We feel we can skate better than them. We have better skaters than they do, and we're going to make them catch us.
Now, Rivermen fans are wondering why the IHL team with the best record is staring at elimination.
We're not playing very good right now. We're not dumping it in. We're not getting on top of Indianapolis. They're beating us at our own type of game. They're kind of outplaying us a little bit in our own end of the rink. And actually, the thing is, they're just capitalizing on their chances that they're getting, and we're not right now.
It's not an excuse. The puck's not rolling for us. You know, it hasn't rolled for us in the last three or four games. Tonight, I thought we outplayed this club outside of the first period. We got down 3-1. We did everything to come back. Every time the puck would roll their way, they'd pick it up and go in and put it in the net.
And Darryl will end after last night's 5-4 loss to the Indianapolis Checkers. Should the Rivermen win tonight?
Nail-biter.
But they showed a lot of heart, and they came from behind to win in that third period. And it sets up a big one tomorrow night, because tonight in Indianapolis, the Rivermen won 4-3 over the Checkers of Indianapolis. They were even at 2 after the first two. And in 1:22 to third, the Checkers took a 3-2 lead, but then got a goal. Peoria did at 6:13 from Don Keller, and an unassisted hoop. Or a hoop, a goal. It seemed like a hoop for him, for Brad Kempthorne at 8:36, and that was the winner. Now, doors open tomorrow night at 6:30. Ticket office opens at 10 o'clock tomorrow. It'll be Wednesday night, and in Game 7, the last final game of the series between Peoria and Indianapolis should be a great one. Tonight in the Stanley, talk to him about the game last night and about the series. Then program tonight, Pat Kelly, of course, the coach of the Rivermen, and Dennis here. And first of all, guys, congratulations on the win last night, Pat. It was good to get even again. And Dennis, you had a big goal the other night. It didn't take long, 17 seconds into that OT, to get it even.
Yes, well, just a good player by Perry Ganscher, dropped the puck to me, and just shot it, just wanted to hit the net, and hit the corner, and I beat your goalie on glove side goal.
It was a must game to win, because you were down one game to none. You tied it up. You went and dropped the game at Fort Wayne. We're going to take a look at the highlights of last night's game, of which you got ahead, but then they came back with a goal. Pat, why don't you pick up the action here?
Well, they did. They scored on a goal that I thought didn't look like anything was going to happen. All of a sudden, it was in our net. We left the guy open in front of their net, in our net, and they scored. But then all heck broke loose, and there was a fight on the ice, and that sort of turned things around for us.
Dennis, where were you in the midst of all of this?
I was on a bench at the time.
Good place. How did this start? Who had the best seat in this thing?
The way I heard that, they were, Perry Ganscher sort of give her a goalie a high stick, he high stick Perry first, and then there was a little push and shoving, and one of their players come off the bench, and then another guy come off the bench, and that left, made two of our guys leave the bench, and that's, I think that's what got it going. If their players had stayed on the bench, I don't think this would have happened, all this fighting.
And there are a couple suspensions coming out of this?
Very possible. There's two, definitely. They're getting two players. The Channel will be suspended for 3 games. Baldwin for 2, and we could lose a player, and they could lose another player, yet we'll know tomorrow morning.
Then after that, you got 2 quick goals. Dennis, you were involved in one of them.
Yes, well, I think we scored 10 seconds right after the fight. I forechecked their defenseman behind the net, filled the puck, give it to Doug Evans from the net, and they put the puck in the net. And then a few minutes later, Tyrus Zatinsky came out with a great effort and got us to lead 3-1, so it was great.
We're going to be on Talk About Sports on the radio side in just a bit. Thanks for coming by, and good luck tomorrow night, and let's get that third game.
We need that one, Dave. That's a plus for us.
All right, Dennis, Pat, thanks a lot for coming by.
Men spent part of their Sunday evening. They had a bench, stick, uniform, even police clearing brawl with the Comets. By the time it's over, 8 players are kicked out. But the Rivermen were as mad as you-know-what, scored the next 3 goals.
That'll mean a lot to me and probably to the other 17 players on this team. And, you know, it's really, for myself, being a rookie this year and coming in, winning the league championship the very first year, means an awful lot. Personally, it's going to be the highlight of my career. I've never gone in playoffs, full games, out of 7 series, and this is going to be the 3rd one for me now. And I'm looking forward to a good series, but when we win it, I'm going to have a good time, and I'll remember it.
It's going to come down to the last who wants it.
Game 7, and Lee Norwood says this time, the home ice advantage will mean something.
Well, I'll tell you what, 7th game, we have the advantage. We're going to have
hopefully lots of fans out there, 7,000 plus hopefully, and we're going to come out ready, and they're going to see one whale of hockey.
The Civic Center are correct, and they usually are. There should be a crowd of almost 8,000 at the Carver Arena tomorrow night for Game 7 between Peoria and Muskegon. You have to admit the setting and situation is perfect. You could not have written a better script.
Well, the cardiac kids is better. That's what I've been calling them lately, the guys, because how we've done this so often, not just in the playoffs, but all year. They just seem to get their backs to the wall, and that's when they come up. But, we got to, Friday night, there's no tomorrow, so you got to come out ready Friday night.
I think going on the road, seventh game, home, there's no really home ice advantage. I think the pressure's on both clubs. You can't afford to make any mistakes, and you just have to go out and play. And certainly been a long season to all boil down to one game, but I guess it's super for the fans.
Throughout the playoffs, the Rivermen have grown to count on a group of fans they refer to as diehards. These diehards not only go to the home games, but they charge the Rivermen up on the road. And guess who John Glenn ran into last night?
One of the big reasons the Peoria Rivermen were able to down the Lumberjacks on Wednesday night was a small but very noisy group of Rivermen fans that traveled 350 miles north to Muskegon to root Peoria on to victory. Although there were only 20 fans in the contingent, they sure packed a powerful punch.
Rivermen! Hey, Rivermen!
The number one fans, they're playing great, and they deserve all the support they can get.
But it gets in your blood. It really gets in your blood, and then you want to go and help them win. I'll cry.
We're enjoying road trips just as much as home, so you got some hockey fans in your hand.
Not only can these super fans cheer with the best in the league, but they can also predict the outcome of games with greater accuracy than Jimmy the Greek.
We're going to come back Friday, and they're all going to come down from here to Peoria Friday.
While a group of 20 fans can't bring the house down, they sure seem to help the Rivermen's cause.
We had quite a few fans here from Peoria giving us their support, and it just feels great right now. Can't say much more.
John Glenn, 19 Eyewitness Sports.
1,000 seats were sold today, so a lot of good ones left. The series is tied at 3 after last night's win in Muskegon. Dennis Krause and Bill Marshall were there, and they recapped the game.
Muskegon's Walker Arena was packed for Game 6 of the Turner Cup Finals. The hosting Lumberjacks looking to clinch the championship with a win. But goalie Rick Hines and the Rivermen had other ideas. Hines and Muskegon's Michelle Dufour dominated a scoreless first period, giving usually slow-starting Peoria a big boost.
They came out hard in the first 10 minutes, and we expected them to. And we wanted to just walk out of there either down one or tied after the first period, and fortunately we did.
Both teams failed to convert on opportunities early in the second period, and for a while it looked like one goal might be enough to win. Finally, at 11:56, the Rivermen connected. Brian Shaw to Doug Evans for his eighth playoff goal, and it was 1-0 Peoria after two periods. Sensing the kill, the Rivermen attacked a stickless Michelle Dufour at 2:03 of the third, center John Goodwin laying it in for a 2-0 Peoria lead. But with the Rivermen's Lee Norwood sitting out a hooking penalty, Muskegon struck back on the power play. Rod Schutt scored the game's last goal at 4:30 of the third, and Rick Hines was perfect for the last 15 and a half minutes as the Rivermen bounced off the ropes again with a 2-1 victory.
Does it surprise you? It doesn't surprise me. I'm glad it's only one game left. I don't think I could take many more.
They're an excellent hockey team, and they never quit. We knew that. They were down both the other series, and they bounced back. We knew they were going to come in and play tonight.
It kind of shows you the way we've been playing all year. We're down and our backs are against the wall, and I think we had our best performance of the year, maybe, as far as a complete team effort. Everybody just worked their butts off, and we can't ask for much more than that.
Very satisfying for me, because it's no secret I've had a rough playoff, and I've had my disappointments with the coach and the team, but I feel so happy for the boys, because a lot of these guys are young, and they've never even got close to championships, and to be the old veteran and to kind of come in there and help them out. Now I put the pressure on him, we got to go do it in the seventh game, too.
He's our main asset right now, and if Hines can hang in there for one more game, we're going to have the Turner Cup in Peoria.
We can't just think that's what's going to happen. We got to go out there and prove that we're winners. If we want to win it, we got to win it on our building. If we don't win it, then we don't deserve to win it.
So it's only fitting that after another road win for the Rivermen, they sent it back for Game 7, the league's two best teams, one game for the Turner Cup Championship.
Forget it. This town has been great to me, and I'll never forget them.
One day I was on the ground when I needed a hand, and it couldn't be found. Took a long time, but I knew it all now.
goal in Salt Lake City. We won 2 championships, so this is my 3rd time around. It's just as good as the last two.
I want to get a sip out of it first. Nobody's going to get until I get a sip out of it.
Let's do it today. And it was tough out there this morning at 9:30. When I woke up this morning, I thought somebody had just taken a 1,000-pound weight off my shoulders and said, hey, you don't have to worry about anything today. Just go out and do your thing, be Pat Kelly, and have a good time.
Welcome to everybody. Will hockey play in Peoria?
We put in 104 hockey games this year. There's probably another 104 practices. And these guys have probably heard 408 speeches from me, and they want to hear the last one. So all I want to say to them is good luck this summer, and thank you for a hell of a season, guys. I appreciate it from the bottom of my heart.
And we thank you, and come back next year. We'll all do it again.
Great. I never won anything in my life before, and I was glad that to come back here to help the team to win the Turner Cup. So I'm sure it's a great feeling to be a winner.
Rivermen took off the skates and took off through downtown Peoria for parade at noontime. They did it by the book. Fire engine brought them to the courthouse plaza, and Mayor Jim Maloof was waiting with a key to the city. And with this, I think we can say hockey season is around here.
Better feeling of just what you've done, and I think I can say with this all through the summer months, I hope, just that how great a hockey club we had this year and what a great job the guy's done for us.
And I think you said at the end of last week, from a team that was dead to the team that won it, what a story.
I was selling nuts and bolts this time last year in a hardware store in Charlotte, North Carolina. You can believe that.
It didn't affect your accent, though. You maintained your Canadian accent. We're going to take a look at some of the highlights from the other night's championship game. First of all, the crowd.
That was unbelievable.
9,224, the most ever to see a game. And they showed up, and kind of tense in the first period. Both teams played it very close to the vest, not a lot of penalties, and what a play by Rick Hines coming up here.
That's the big save. If they score on that goal, we're down 1-0.
Mm-hmm. And then a bullet from Dennis Sear.
Denny was, you know, when he got 18 goals for us in the playoffs. If St. Louis had sent him back to us for the playoffs, who knows where we would have been. But he was a key man, and along with Hines and four or five other guys, I hate to miss names, but, you know, each person means so much to do their jobs in their areas, and we got those people to do those jobs, and that's why we won the championship.
And this time Muskegon didn't come back until in the third period when you'd had a 3-goal lead.
Right. I think we outplayed them that much and kept them off the good shots. But when Mike Precious put that 4th goal in my heart, I started to celebrate. They're not going to catch us now. It's 4-1.
But you didn't have time to celebrate as soon as you thought because of this whole situation with about 1.5 minutes to go.
That's a set, you know, you hate to see that happen, but I think frustration was in Muskegon's mind, and they had played a tough, hard series and a tough, hard year, and maybe that got something out of their minds and out of their hearts, a little frustration.
A lot of the guys have been here for the last couple of years, and I know guys like the Hammer and Prestige and Kempthorne, guys
Shaw,
that have been here.
Jerry August, it's got to be a great feeling for them. You know, as I told Jerry and Donnie Keller, I know how you guys must feel sitting up in those stands. We won it on the ice, and you won it up in the stands for us, but I'm sure you'd rather been down on the ice with us playing.